All right, so I not did all the work myself. A lot of people helped with this thing, especially Audrey Hatanto, is the PhD student working on this thing. And we did it also together with the University of Amsterdam. So I'm going to talk about you, about the work that we do, about social phobia in virtual reality, and we want to do this kind of a treatment that people can do at home. So to support people there, we also try to introduce a virtual agent who will help people with the work they have to do. So there's a short overview. I want to start with the introduction because different backgrounds, different ideas what people know about this kind of domain. So give an introduction, then I want to focus on virtual health agents, virtual reality system that we built, the therapist application, then a bit of an evaluation that we did, and then some final remarks. Introduction, the first part. Social anxiety. So we focus on social anxiety, which is quite a common mental disorder. In the US, the number is like 30%. And for those who have no idea what it is, social anxiety is a kind of an anxiety that you have that you be negatively evaluated by someone else. Virtual reality therapy, we heard already this morning from the keynote, is a therapy where people are exposed to things they are kind of fear of anxiety. And there have been numbers of meta-analyses already demonstrating quite the effectiveness of virtual reality exposure therapy. With regard to social anxiety, recently Paige Anderson published an RCT where she compared public speaking in virtual reality with a group where they had to do the presentation in front of real people, and the results were kind of comparative. And besides only that one scenario where people speak in front of an audience, in Delft and in Amsterdam, we work on various social situations, which seems also to be able to elicit anxiety. So that's a good starting point. Now, virtual agents, we think, is very interesting in this perspective. Normally, virtual reality is often done in a clinic under the supervision of a therapist, but we think it would be nice if we can give this opportunity that people can do it at home. But since it might be very complex, we thought it would be handy if there's also a kind of a guide, a coach. Now, there's already some work in this area, giving people all kinds of guidance. So we have a very famous part, it's a sim coach from Skip Rizzo, which help soldiers, veterans, and to assess whether they might have a PTSD. Other people working in Boston, Timothy Bickmore, is also working on virtual health agents, but these are more kind of virtual doctors or nurses which people can help in the hospital. This one is, for example, I think it's a discharge nurse. And then there's also some work we did in Delft ourselves, which was a little coach which was on the top of your website for people to motivate people to keep on going with their health activities, for it could be dieting or exercising. And we're just putting these simple smileys and this kind of thing, all right, you did very well. It already had an effect compared to where we left out this little puppet which says, oh, you've done so good. So that sees, for us, was a kind of an idea that it might be really helpful to have a kind of a virtual agent. So the system that we have in mind and that we built, and we'll talk about, is, so you have, now let's see, is the magic this one? Yeah, so the patient at home with the HMD on can see a virtual world, for example, a classroom where you have to give a presentation. And on the laptop, there's a virtual coach who can afterwards tell you how well you did it and explain it. You also communicate through a server, and the server is the therapist can connect. It doesn't have to be at the same time, so maybe at the end of the week the therapist go in and see how well you did and might communicate to you back. Yeah. So that's the vision. So now what I want to talk about is each individual step. I just, as kind of disclaimer, so I'm not going to present a wonderful RCT with all the effect. We're still in a bit of a technology phase trying to figure out how it actually works. So it's that's the state it is in. The virtual health agents. So the virtual health agent, what does it do in this kind of application? It tells you a couple of things. It helps the patient with the technology, because it has lots of stuff people get. You really get a suitcase with an HMD in it, heart rate tracker, your speaker, a manual, and there's lots of kind of wires and everything. So the coach takes you through step by step how you'd have to plug in everything. That's already complicated. So that's what the coach is doing. One thing is doing. But, so we have two coaches, by the way. One is female, one is male. So the patient can select one. The first thing what the coach is also doing is setting treatment goals. So he asks the patient, so what are your goals? What do you want to get out of this one? They can type it in and he gives you hints how to improve your goals, make it more realistic. Another thing the coach is doing is psychoeducation. It will try to explain to the patient what it means to have, what social anxiety is, and also explains the idea behind the treatment. So this is all given to the patient and it's explained by the coach. And another important thing, and what the coach is also doing, is after you've been in virtual reality, we have collected all this data, and then the coach will explain what it means. It will give an interpretation of what it means that your heart rate went up or down. And I have a little video of this, and it will be always challenging. See if it works. And so if you want to learn Dutch, this is your opportunity, but I will put some subtitles there, because maybe...
In de grafieken zie ik twee trends. Ten eerste, je angstniveau, de combinatie van je angstscore en hartslag, begon relatief hoog en nam gedurende de oefening af. Deze oefening laat mooi zien dat na een tijd de angst vanzelf afneemt. Precies wat we met deze oefening willen bereiken. Erg goed, heel mooi resultaat.
Oké, okay. The coach does several things, give an interpretation, explain what's happening, and also motivate you, like, this is good, this is what we expected, and also, because some people might think, all right, I'm still nervous, is this good? And then we have to explain, yes, that's exactly what we want you to be nervous, and also that it goes down. But, of course, you can have different patterns, so we have a kind of a pattern mechanism to figure out how to interpret and what kind of advice we can give to these patients. Okay, the virtual reality system. So we have built 19 scenarios because the psychologists definitely wanted to have variations in all kinds of scenarios. So we really went over the top. And they also wanted to have a very long conversation. So the previous system that we made was like 5 minutes, the discussion dialogue that you have. But they said, no, longer. So we ended up with, on average, like an 18-minute dialogue that you could have with these virtual characters. And we also use free speech, so people could say anything to these characters, and these characters have to respond. That was a challenge, and I will explain how we tried to react to that. And it was automatic response, because there's no one else in the house, the system has to respond. If you talk to a character, the character has to say something back. And that was automatically done. Okay, some of the scenarios. So top one is having a lunch or a dinner with an old friend. The next one is a kind of an interview on the street about, we have three types of interviews, it could be religion, your sexual orientation, and what was the other, it's also cumbersome, your views on foreigners. So all by kind of topic that might not be really easy to talk about. The next one, they have to return an item to the shop, there were some holes in your trousers and you want your money back. The other one, the lower one, here, you're on a party, and someone comes up to you and have a discussion, just fill the time with this person. Then the next one is a general practitioner, the first time you meet him, so you can ask all kinds of nasty and strange, embarrassing questions. And this is someone else who's also doing a street interview. This one is a room, a class setting, it's an English course, so everyone has to say something, and it's sometimes your turn or the other classmates, and the classmates also make nasty comments or nice comments to each other also about you or not. It's a job interview. Someone you can meet here as well on a bus, who's a foreigner, ask for all kinds of directions, other stuff you buy in a shop, blind date, and just as a public speak, as you have to talk in front of an audience. So lots of variations. That's what you mentioned. So this is another video, and then you see it's how it might work. So the example here you will see is with a general practitioner, and I'm a patient, and I will see this general practitioner for the first time.
Goedendag, ik ben dokter Martijn van der Heijden. Welkom in het gezondheidscentrum. Ik begrijp dat je hier nieuw in de wijk bent. Wat is je volledige naam?
Willem Paul Brinkman.
Wat is je geboortedatum?
30-12-1970.
Dat is goed. Waar ben je verzekerd?
Dat is een goede vraag, dat weet ik even niet.
Om je in te schrijven als patiënt heb ik wat algemene en medische informatie van je nodig. Ik stel voor dat we gewoon stap voor stap door de vragen heen lopen en ik zal je antwoorden gelijk in het systeem invoeren. De eerste vraag. Ben je wel eens geopereerd en waarvoor was dat en wanneer?
Oké, this goes on and on and on. So, didn't want to do the 18 minutes, but you got an idea. Oh, I can do it. Okay, so the dialogues. That is tricky, of course, because you have free speech and how do you react to all this kind of thing? So, in a sense, we see the avatar was always leading and we work with kind of dialogue units, which means an avatar asks a question, a patient says something, and then an avatar gives a response. So this is the kind of unit we repeat and repeat each time. So in an average scenario, you have like 78 dialogue units. And depending what kind of response, we use sometimes speech detection, which is simply we know you stop talking and now we have to say something. That's something we do. Or keyword detection. The system listened if he can hear specific keywords, and if he finds a specific keyword, then he comes back with an appropriate response. But most of the time we couldn't use speech detection or keyword detection, so we had to come up with a strategy with the avatar would respond to you. If it would, you got the idea that he was actually listening to you, but it doesn't actually listen to you, it only knows that you stop talking. So we came up with 8 strategies, and maybe you don't find the talk interesting, but you can use these strategies also on the telephone. So if you have to talk to someone, it's blah 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 blah, you're not listening to it, then you can come back with these responses, you will see. So, for example, shop assistant, can you also specify to me the price range that you're aiming for? Then the patient could say anything, la-di-da-di-da-di-da, and then we come back to the shop assistant, well, that's fine. Yes? So with 8 of these kind of strategies, whatever you say, it seems appropriate. Another one. So, for example, state opinion based on your beliefs, emotions. So this is what you can always do, for example. So what makes a good team leader? So what's a job interview? So patient says la-di-da-di-da-di-da, and then you can come back. Yes, but honestly, I feel that you're not ready to become a good team leader by judging your answer and your current experience. I mean, you can always say this. So we have come up with all these kinds of answers. So we can, that makes it very easy that people can just say anything and they believe that they're actually talking. Sometimes it works because we take keywords and sometimes we fall back to these kind of tricks. So we have 80 of these scenarios, you can see them in the paper. So, and you can then use them for if you want to efficiently telephone. If you don't want to listen to someone, you do something else. In the end, you pick one from the list and you say, yes, I can see where you're going, but I'm not sure if I agree with you. Something like that. Yes, so we can continue on this kind of thing. What we also did, using phobic stresses. Because in exposure, the idea is that you can create anxiety. So if people get used to it, you have to come up with new kind of stresses. So the phobic stresses that one of we were using was the dialogue itself. We could be nice answers, not kind of positive kind of questions, or negative. So an example of a positive unit, I would like to know your taste of music. What kind of music do you like? Patient says something, la-di-da-di-da. And then the after they come back, cool, nice taste of music. So it's kind of a positive unit. Negative, you could do. So you start already negative in the question. I don't think that you have a good taste of music, but in case I'm wrong, can you tell me what type of music you like? Now, the patient says something, come back the other time, as I expected, you don't know nothing about good music. So this gives you ways to manipulate kind of the stress or the anxiety you try to elicit. We did a previous work, and it's PLONS 1, we published it, in which we combined, so we had a kind of an 18-minute dialogue, in which we controlled the ratio of positive or negative kind of units. And if the units go to more negativity, you can see here, so if they become more and more, you get negative questions, you see the heart rate goes nicely up. And if we go less, more positive, then the heart rate goes down. So it's a nice controller of stress, which we could use in this environment. Another stressor that we use were eye gaze and body posture. So avatars could stare at you or not looking at you, could be also a thing. Or doing public speaking, they could really listen, be interested, be bored, or sit a bit more critically, like, are you really telling me something that is relevant and does it really make sense? Another part that we also looking was a feedback loop that we incorporated. So it measures your heart rate and it asks you also every 4 minutes your score, and score from 1 to 10, how scared you are. And we use that to feed that back into the system. And if you were below a set target level from the therapist, then the system says, all right, we can make it more scarier. So it, for example, increases the ratio of negative answers or start adjusting the gaze of the thing. Were you too scared, then it could go down. So this way we could control the anxiety that we want to evoke. The therapist application. So the therapist had an application where you can use and see how things were going with the patient. So one of the first thing, and it's all so small, so I have to look at it, this is the treatment plan. So after the first session where the therapist, the patient set his own goal, he's also indicating which social situations he find more scary, and also the days when he could do the treatment. This was all sent to the server, and it was picked up by the therapist, and he makes a treatment plan specifically for this patient. He would say, all right, we start the first 2 weeks with, or 2 days, with this kind of environment, and then we move on to this environment, and we set this specifically stressors for you. So he could do this, and then afterwards he sent up the treatment plan to the server, which then will be picked up by the patient when he starts with the application again. Therapists can also see the overview, what were things going on. So this is the overall treatment, so session 1, 2, 3, and it would be a heart rate and set scores. This could be during one session, could be multiple exposures, and in one exposure every 4 minutes. So he could have an overview how things are going with his of a patient. Treatment history, when he were locked on, could also see when he filled in questionnaires, this kind of things. And the last one, we have also kind of a secured email exchange between the therapist and the patient, which was secured, so it was not a normal email that Google might look into. Evaluation. Now, we also tried to evaluate this. So we did a very small, we started with a very small test in Delft with non-patients, just to see if the whole thing would work. We asked 5 people to do this. Beforehand we started this. Now that worked all quite fine. People, we got the suitcase at home, no problems there. So we thought, all right, now let's start with 5 real patients. This was then done in Amsterdam. So they had 5 people with sociophobia, 2 males and 3 females, age ranging between 38 and 64. Now, the setup of the treatment was you have an introduction, so you had to come to the clinic. The therapist would explain the idea of the study, demonstrate the system one time, and then the patient would take a suitcase with him home, and then there were 10 sessions at home. One was introduction. Again, the coach would explain the whole system, also do a calibration for the voice, but also your anxiety measure, you get a personal anxiety measurement, was done. And then you have session 2 to 9, where you did extra exposure, and the last session was relapse prevention. And the, in this setup, what we did was, because they were a bit hesitant, the clinicians, they said, we call each time. So when the patient starts, we call them first, and we will keep on the telephone. Okay, so we didn't build to that it was needed, but they say, look, it's ethical in this point of time that we listen into this. We don't leave the patient completely on his own. Okay, so what I said, they got a lot of equipment at home, so a suitcase, the heart rate, HMDs, mic, laptop, a manual, and we also gave them all kinds of videos with explaining the whole system and questions if things go wrong. Measurement that we took a subjective unit of discomfort, so there's a scale from 1 to 10 again. Present measurement we did, and heart rate every 4 minutes. Now the results. That was not what we planned. So we did so much work to test everything, but we made a major mistake, and maybe you can learn from that. So we tested everything on one laptop, and it worked wonderful. But then I want to buy 4 of these new laptops, but they were out. They were not anymore, I could not buy them. So I bought new laptops. I compiled the software, we compiled it on this one, and we thought we can run it on this one. Major mistake. So we give it to the patient, and 4 out of 5, at the end, they gave up. It was really not working, and we had to cancel their treatment. We had to give them normal treatment. Only one patient was able to continue, because he got the system that we had used for the beta test. Okay, so that was a bummer, but still we have some data to evaluate it. So the present score that we get was quite high. If we compare it to the data which is online for all kinds of other tests, so that was good. Now, subjective unit of discomfort. So to understand this, on this here, are the different exposure sessions. So we ended up with something like 22 exposure sessions that you could do. And this is the search score for 1 to 10. And here, because we have like 204 samples of people giving every 4 minutes their anxiety. And we did analysis. And what we did an analysis looking at the sessions, just between the sessions, where the anxiety drops, and within a session, because they have multiple exposures. And both were significant for this small group. But you see only one patient continued at the end, so the data here is just from one patient. Same on heart rate, we had also 204 samples. Again, it dropped the heart rate between the sessions and also within the sessions. So, for the pilot study, the system was able to provoke anxiety. You saw this drop over time also, so that's what we expected over time. The habituation sets in, but still, a bit of the bummer was that we only got at one patient that could really finish the whole thing. So we're now rerunning the pilot, but this time we do it in a lab to make sure if... So we set up all the technology there and then we put the patient in the lab and we're not there. But if something go wrong with some of the plugs fall out, then our technician can help. Because the focus is not can everyone put in the right plug. Because we envision over a couple of years, someone has made a much more better hardware and these kind of things, and then this problem will be gone. And we're also embedding the system, the Memphis system is called, in another clinics, and there we give it as a kind of a homework exercise. So people have a normal meeting with the therapist, and then they get the suitcase and do 2 sessions at home just to see how it works. And we want to figure out what's the acceptance of this kind of thing. And that was it for me. Thank you very much.